know, is that, you know, that happened to me as a child, and I get older and that happens, and my whole life is gone now.
Guys are parents and friends, you might have gotten a little lost. He was talking about the trial.
I know Mark a little, so, and he is this way, so I never said something to him. Because I thought it might embarrass him, and so me too, if I gushed. But that's what occasions like this are for, to gush and embarrass people. So, you know, people talk about movies that they've seen in their early childhood that had an effect on them. Not TV, like The Wizard of Oz, but films you go and see in a theater. And a lot of people hear Star Wars was like the first movie they saw that had that impact. First movie I saw that was like that was a movie called Tom Thumb. Mark Rydell did not direct that movie. It horrified me. I still haven't recovered from it. I was just an infant. But the next movie he also didn't direct, that was Lawrence of Arabia. I vaguely remember like camels and a train and a motorcycle, and my family was like all abuzz about it. But the first movie that I personally would think that I remember of having an experience with, I saw by myself. In fact, I snuck and saw it twice. It was about, in early America, a young adolescent boy who takes up with this ne'er-do-well, and they go on a lark. The ne'er-do-well was played by Steve McQueen, and I later found out it was a book written by William Faulkner, and it was a movie called The Reavers that Mark Rydell directed. So there you have it. And then, you know, later I read, in preparation for this, his bio, and I see that, well, you know, I knew he had directed The Cowboys, but I didn't know that he produced Jeremiah Johnson and Scarecrow, an early Gene Hackman, Al Pacino movie that like was very big to me. He directed Gunsmoke and I Spy episodes. This guy like raised me. So forgive me if I gush a little here. Not all great talents get to find their voice, and with the expensive canvas that is the cinema, that is especially true. But sometimes, some do, and it has an impact, and it is good. And I am very proud to introduce you to a man who is on a first-name basis with genius, Mark Rydell.
Very old man when I heard all this. I realized, how the hell did I do all that? It's very exciting. I gotta tell you, it's really a real pleasure and an honor to be asked to speak at a graduation ceremony. Actors are my primary love in life. They're the best kind of people in the world. They take chances that very few people, very few professions allow. And they're the only people I know whose job it is to really undress emotionally in front of the world, whose instrument is themselves, and whose job is to really know themselves and try and find all the stuff in them so that they can use it, or so that I can use it. I think it's in a sense preaching to the converted already to tell you that craft and training. It's so easy to say you're an actor, because you can talk, you can walk into an office and say, I'm an actor. But acting is a craft, it's an art, it's a profession, it's a really wonderful profession. And it's very important that we continue to understand how much goes into it. I always find actors are so brave. When I walk onto the set and I have actors doing something that's really revealing, emotionally revealing, I'm always amazed at the willingness that an actor has to expose himself in that way. not easy. On the other hand, it's fun. At its best, it's fun. When you pass through the anxious moments of creating a role, and you get to the pleasure of experiencing it, it's really fun. So I welcome you to this world of art that we are all addressing ourselves to. I probably should say that again. I welcome you to this world of art that we're all experiencing. I welcome you. Oh, you've done that. It's just I learned about craft when I was a musician. I was a musician before I was an actor and director. And you cannot pretend to be a musician. You can't walk in and say, I'm a violinist, or I'm a... The next step is play. So I learned early on that training yourself, so you have a craft and a technique, and so that you're confident about what you, how to approach what it is you're going to do on a stage or on a set, it's so important. It's so important. And I'm so delighted that you have had the wisdom to recognize this importance, and that you worked for some time to get to this point where you're graduating. But don't fool yourself. Graduation doesn't mean the end. You know, it's the beginning. It's the beginning of training. Training has to go on. You have to be aware all the time. You know, I was lucky. I grew up in the 50s in the theater in New York. And I was just talking to Anthony Hopkins out of that, and he told me that his favorite book was The Fervent Years by Harold Clerman. Does anybody know that book yet? You should. Go get yourself a copy of The Fervent Years. It's the story of the group theater. And the group theater was the theater that brought Stanislavski's Train to the United States. The group theater was a theater that existed in 1930, I think 31 to 41, or to 40. And it was comprised of Lee Strasberg, who was one of its founders, and Joe Crawford, Harold Clerman, and Bobby Lewis, and Sanford Meisner, and Stella Adler, and Elia Kazan, and you could, one could go on forever. And actors that you know, John Garfield, for those of you who are old enough to remember John Garfield, Francis O'Toole, great actors, Lee Cobb, E.J. Cobb. And they formed a theater in the 30s, and it was, they all went off to the country and studied together and worked together and worked with the passion that I heard tonight, the excitement, the enthusiasm that I heard in everybody tonight was really thrilling. And I was sitting backstage, it's quiet back there. It's dark. Tony says, do you know what you're going to say? I said, I don't know what I'm going to say. Before we start a picture, and I tell them that all we are is a very sophisticated recording device with lights and cameras and tape recorders and elements like that. And we're all there for one reason. We are there to record the event that the actor has to create. And everything has to go everything has to go that's not important to that creation of that event. And that's your responsibility. And it's a tough one to live out the event in front of hundreds of people, with people putting a tape to your nose and people making you up. And meantime, you're supposed to play a love scene or a major intimate moment in your life you have to reveal. And that's why I admire the actor, and I think that the actor needs to be respected in the most fervent way, because he's the one, he and she, by the way, are the ones who have to create the life that we are going to witness. You know, if that moment that the actor creates is not real, I don't care how brilliant the camera work, how brilliant the set design, how brilliant all the elements of sound and picture are, it's worthless when you have a bad recording. You have a good recording of a bad event, it doesn't work. You can have, by the way, if the event is real, the recording can be inferior and it'll still work. So you are the ones who are at the crucial point of creation in the moment of acting when you are on set. Everything is subservient to what you do and your training that you have experienced with Joanne and EW and all the other teachers that you have, whose names I don't know, is going to carry you for a long time. It's an endless study. You have to keep going, you have to keep yourself aware, you have to keep yourself open to experience, to relationships, to situations. You have to keep learning. You should study painting, you should study art, you should study music, you should study all those wonderful areas that will feed you, which will make you sensitize you. Because that's what you're the one who has, the experience has to go through you. It's whether your instrument is true and clear and free that will make the difference. If you have impediment to the expression of your talent, you'll have an inferior performance. If you give yourself the privilege of opening yourself to experience the other actor, to experience the set, to experience the situation, to experience the needs of your character, the character that you're playing, to personalize it so that it becomes part of you, so that it matters to you, you can make a real contribution in this world. The world of art is so delicious. There are so many people and professions that are a bore. You are on your way. Tenacity that you have to have. Because unfortunately in this world there's no shortage of people to say no to you. Because you're going to face a lot of no. Thank you very much. Send in the next person, you know? You're going to face a lot of that. And it's painful. But you have to be tenacious. When I was a student at the Neighborhood Playhouse, I was 19 or 20. And Lee Cobb was playing on Broadway in Death of a Salesman. One of the great performances that was ever seen on the American stage, in my estimation. My father was a friend of his. And my father used to play handball with him at an athletic club in New York. And my father, trying to impress me one day, said, "You want me to get some tickets to Death of a Salesman? You know, you couldn't get into the theater." I said, "Jesus, really? Could you get tickets?" "Absolutely." He goes to Cobb and he comes and he shows me he's got two tickets, row A, double A, center. I was trembling with excitement, trembling. And we went to the Roscoe Theater to see Death of a Salesman. And we sat literally in the first row. The apron of the stage was over our laps. Aprons. Our knees were under the stage. That's how close we were. And I watched this performance by Lee Cobb and Arthur Kennedy played his son. And the tears splashed on us. It was so powerful, so moving, so overwhelming, so capturing an experience. Your breath went out of your body. The curtain came down at the end. One hand, you know, you heard clapping, and it began, thunderous applause began. Made me weep. As a matter of fact, I can feel it again. I feel the emotion of the moment. Again, I was so grateful to have been present and witnessing that performance. And my father said to me, "You want to go back and see Lee Kahn?" He says, "He's expecting us." So we went backstage, and I was absolutely trembling. And his dressing door opened, and there was Lee Kahn in a robe. He was white, he was sallow, he was exhausted. The performance had literally drained him. And I was awestruck by being even in the same room with him. And he sat down, and he was very courteous, and he talked to me. Knew that I was a student at the Neighborhood Playhouse, and I was studying with Sandy Meisner, who of course was a cohort of his. And he said to me, "Are you any good?" I said, "You know, I think maybe a bit." He said, "Well, if you are good, hang on. No matter who tells you no, hang on. You'll get your chance. And when you get your chance, if you're ready, if you have trained yourself, if you have the craft to fulfill the moment, then you're going to be fine. You just have to hang on till you get your shot." So that's my last words to you. You've started your training. You've graduated. Your training will continue if you're smart. Stay ready. Resist no. You're going to be told it many times. Hang in there. If you believe in yourself, you'll get a chance. And if you get a chance and you're ready, everything can happen. So I wish you best of luck.
Probably know we were fortunate enough to have Robert De Niro as our keynote speaker, and at the time some of the graduates were asking, "So who are you going to get next year?" with this kind of like smirk. I really can't remember who it was. There's a couple of people, but I think I can say with pretty much confidence that they are duly unsmirked. Anthony Hopkins is a Welshman who went to London and the RADA, later the National Theatre. He started in television doing stage plays, classical works. He's done a ton of that stuff over the years. Shakespeare, Chekhov, perhaps my favorite play of all time he did for television, Little Eyolf by Ibsen. A lot of highbrow television movies. He won an Emmy for the Lindbergh kidnapping case, later another for playing Hitler in The Bunker. In feature films, he's been associated with classy productions, The Bounty, 84 Charing Cross Road. But a larger audience responded to him in a somewhat less lofty piece of material entitled The Silence of the Lambs. The doctor in The Elephant Man, do you remember that? These were decent, good men. And I've been known to say that this happens to be the quality that is most difficult for an actor to fake, if it can be done at all. It's interesting for me to see if someone has the balls to go back to the theater after they've made it, and he did and does. He's done Pravda, Anthony and Cleopatra, King Lear, and M. Butterfly on the stage since his film success. He did Equus in Los Angeles. He directed and wrote the score for August, an adaptation of Uncle Vanya. He still does the classic movies, the stuff with Merchant Ivory, Howard Zinn, Surviving Picasso, recently Glad he's not above plugging into that zeitgeist with Zorro opening up. To go see here, especially. For God's sake, the man was knighted. let me just get him on here lastly by saying that I have used his performance in Remains of the Day many times. I use it in my instruction as a example of executing consistent, disciplined actions to create a character. You know, actors often worry that they have a lot, that they need to do a lot of different things, or that they're not going to show their underlying emotional condition, and they bounce all over the place. But his clarity and specificity in creating that reserved person, and he held the line against the onslaught of a deeply felt emotional truth by carving each moment, whether it was the thrill of love or the agony of loss. There was this commitment to each thing done. And so you have in this portrayal of a singular person the tragedy and heroism of all our struggles with nature, and that is what a craftsperson can do for you. Ladies and gentlemen, I am so very proud to introduce to you the keynote speaker for the graduating class of 1998, Anthony Hopkins.
Same town as Richard Burton, and he was a kind of, he was an inspiration for me because he was the local boy who got out of Wales and became a movie actor or movie star, whatever you want to call it. And I wanted to follow in the same business, but I had no idea what I was letting myself in for. As I said, I was really a loser as an actor at the school. I went to the Royal Academy, I tried some auditions, and God knows why they accepted me and they took me in on a scholarship. And I had no idea what I had to do. I was blessed with a good voice, good Welsh voice. And I thought all you had to do was act. And act. And a tone. And a voice. So that was the style of British acting in those days, you know? Or a voice. Shakespeare. But not being an intellectual giant, or not being a rocket scientist, I didn't know much about Shakespeare, nor did I want to. Because it was so badly taught at school. But I remember we were asked to do, in our first week, by this acting teacher to do our, he got a few of us up to do our audition pieces, whatever they were, always a bit of Shakespeare's and Chekhov. And this American student called Larry Koenig, He studied at the Theatre Wing in New York. And he got up and he did Richard II. And of course, there was a sort of reaction before he got up and did this. You know, how can this guy do Richard II? No, he got up and did Shakespeare's Richard II. It was fantastic, amazing performance. And I got to know this guy. I said, how did you do that? And he told me about method. Well, I'd already been introduced to that by watching Brando on the waterfront, Street Gun and Desire. And I'd never seen acting like that, that taxi cab scene in On the Waterfront. That was acting beyond acting. And we had a few good actors in England, like Albert Finney and Peter O'Toole, who were of that kind of look, you know, who had that kind of danger, that sort of threat and power. But I used to hang around with Larry and Larry Koenig, and he introduced me to. We used to go to bookstores, and I didn't have any money, so I used to steal a few books. I remember I got Michael Chekhov's To the Actor. I got Boleslavsky's First Six Steps, I think it was called. And I got Robert Louis's Method of Madness. And one of my favorite books was The Fervent Years. So, although I was living in London, and I was an English student or a British student, I was aware of a whole different kind and style of acting or a training and a discipline that was alien to my country, you know. Because it was in England, with all due respect, it was all voice and technique, which is nothing bad with that, that's fine. But I was fascinated by this whole process, and I was a fan of all the so-called, you know, the method actors, you know, John Garfield and Brando and all those people. And one of the names that came up was Henry Meisner, and then Stella Adler, and Porter Hark, and people like that, and of course Lee Strasberg. And I wanted to be an American actor. I wanted to be that sort of an actor myself. I had no idea how to put it together. So I joined a little breakaway group, which was Stanislavski group. It was run by a man called Christopher Fettes and Jan Malmgren. And I joined them for about a year. And then, as destiny would have it, I got very muddled, and I didn't know what I was supposed to be doing, and I would read everything I could on Stanislavski, and I would write enormous subtext in my script until I couldn't even see the script, you know. Just covered pages of subtext, what I had for breakfast, what I had for dinner. Super objective was, and I didn't know why, I couldn't even speak the lines. The director said, why don't you just speak the line? Because I didn't have to think why. Eventually I came to New York. I worked with Laurence Olivier, and I'm only giving you this, perhaps. I'm not trying to give you a life story, but I'm just trying to get to what I'm here to do tonight. And and that was it. And I came to New York and in 1974 to do a play called Echoes. And, I was introduced to a woman there, who was Mary Doyle, who was a student with the Sandy Meisner. And I went and visited the actor's studio and all that. And anyway, the years went by. What I'm trying to get to it, as the years have gone by, I know less and less about acting. I've been asked by students, I've been asked by, you know, I recently, because I've been doing this for Mark Azzaro and Mask Azzaro, or have I even forgotten the title? I'm very irreverent about acting, you see, because I've been asked by journalists, you know, doing publicity, how did you do that part in Hannibal? That's Hannibal Lecter. I said, I don't know. Just learn the lines, show up, and make sure that the check's on the way in the bank. I said, is that all you do? I said, yeah. The truth is, I don't know what else to say. Because I'm asked by saying, how would you start in this business? I mean, what would you say to a young actor? I said, I don't know what I would say. But what I just heard Mark Rennell saying, you just stay with it. Just stay with it. Work at it and have some fun with it. But I think what I've done over the years, maybe it's a defense mechanism of mine, but I've tried to demystify the process of acting. I try to keep it very simple. I keep it simple for myself. And I do, the truth is, people say, how did you do that? How did you, I just heard my name mentioned, like, I think it was Remains of the Day. They say, how did you play that butler? I said, well, I just walk very quietly and speak very quietly. How did you play Hannibal Lecter? I said, well, I just, you know, I I'm not going anywhere, and stuck in a glass. Walking around the place much, just to stand very still and speak very quietly. Oh, but he's a maniac. Yeah, but if you, you know, play it like that, I said, you know, you can sort of just say, one talent. So being a dyslexic, ADD sufferer, the only hunch I have, or the only instinct I have, and I do believe in instinct and intuition, and to be serious, because you are graduating students, and I don't want you to be as irreverent as I am, but I do say it, have a sense of humor about it all. Have fun with acting, because it's the greatest, it sure beats working for a living, I can tell you that. And in those hours when I said, you know, I just say, Agent Stark. I have a sense that the audience has got to do the work for me. You let the audience do the work. And the cinema, and the movie camera, is the greatest friend you can ever have, because it does all the work for you, and that's all you have to do is literally learn your lines, show up and do it. There is probably more to do it, but I think what it happens is it comes to experience and years of experience. And I go on learning. I've just been making a film with Ron Schwery and produced it at Marty Brest and Brad Pitt. It's called Meet Joe Black, and I had a lot of text to learn, a lot of lines to learn. And I thought, well, the only way to do this is just learn the stuff, just learn it so much. Just know the text inside out and backwards. And it's not about saying what my sense memory is or motion memory, but what am I doing in the scene? What is my intention towards Brad or whoever I'm playing on? Yeah. What is my intention? What is the action? What is the objective of the character? What am I doing in the scene? Not what am I feeling? And that's all I understand. I've been asked to teach. I can't teach a damn thing. I could stand here for hours and answer questions, but I couldn't teach you anything because I don't know where to begin. I don't know. I mean, I can't direct. I've tried to direct, but I leave that to the directors. I know how to act, but I don't really know the basic stuff that's involved. I know I have my own method, and that is to be committed to the part, to know it so well, inside out and backwards, know it so well without having to think about it. I remember, I can tell you that my first experience on film was with Catherine Hepburn. It was a film called Lion and Winter with Peter O'Toole. She transmitted to me, which I hope I could transmit to you in graduation and in this amazing business you're going into. We were doing a scene, rehearsing a scene together. It was my first scene in any major movie, my first movie. And I was working with this great movie star, and we did this rehearsal, and we were in full sort of, you know, dressed up in all that costume on. And I did everything wrong. I tripped over the cables, and I got my clothes. And I acted up a storm. And when the director said, okay, take a break and we'll be, you know, we'll light the second meal, you know, come back in an hour. And she said, would you like a coffee? And I said, yeah. Tell me, do you like the camera? So she said, do you like the camera? I said, do I like it? Yeah, the bread and butter machine, do you like it? I said, you mean the camera? Yeah. I said, yeah, she said, good. She said, don't play the whole scene with the back of your head to it. She said, I'll give you a tip. She said, you've got a good voice, you've got a good head, she's got a lot of muscle in you. She said, don't act. She said, don't act. Don't let anyone see you acting. I said, don't act. She said, don't act. Just speak the lines. I said, that's all you have to do. I said, well, isn't it called acting? She's just speaking. She watched Spencer Tracy, watched the best of them, watched Carrie and all those people. She said, don't make a big deal of it. She said, just speak your lines. And I couldn't get it. I didn't know what she meant, but I know what she meant now. And it is to do with that. It is to do with the text. As Stanislavski asked Salvini, the great tragedian, he said, how do you play Othello? How do you play tragedy? And Salvini said, voice, voice, and more voice. But what he meant was that not just the vocal voice, but a Margaret Dodger said, as Mr. Dodger said just now, the commitment. I was talking to Ron Shirley backstage about talent, you know, and about experience. I don't know, people say, what is the definition of talent? I have no idea. What is the definition of success? The only version I have of success is sheer luck. Luck and a bit of talent and being there at the right time. But even that's a kind of magical thing, which I can't even analyze. Talent, I think, is something that develops and develops and develops. And if you have a gift, you have to go on nurturing it, learning about it, committing to it, being more disciplined about it, being more economical about it, and being more humble about it, I think. And having a sense of humor about it all. As I said, it sure beats working for a living. I wish I could say something which was profound. I can't. I feel very honored to be here because it's been a tremendous journey for me. I wanted to come to America ever since I was a little kid. And when I go back over the many years when I met that student in the Royal Academy, and I responded to those magical names like Sandy Meisner, the Group Theatre, Neighborhood Playhouse, the Actors Studio. When I responded to all that, it was like a kind of talisman. It was a sort of imprint in my brain, in my subconscious. And I wanted to come to America and become an American actor. Well, my accent hasn't changed, but I hope I've been able to absorb something of the wonderful sort of acting that goes on here in America. And it's been an incredible journey because I never knew it would be possible to do this, and that it would happen. So when Ron Shirley asked me if I would attend this graduation, I said, yeah, sure, I'd love to. It's a strange, mysterious journey for me, and it's all part of my life and part of my experience. And I just leave you with no profundity, no depth. Commitment, simplicity. I think Lauren Taylor, the great American actress, said that when she was on stage, she was doing the Glass Menagerie. I think it was something like Harold Grove said to her, he said, you never seem to come to our groups, you never seem to think about it very much, you never analyze what you do. How do you get so real? And she looked at him and she said, I just listen. And I believe for myself, I may be completely wrong in this, I've had to devise my own method. I've given up writing subtext, by the way. Yeah. I mark my script in lots of colors, and I mark little marks, which is numbers, and I go over the script over and over, sometimes 200 times, you know, I go through the stuff over and over, so that I can sleep it and think it. But in that process, the most important thing for me, and I think for all acting, and I believe, I tell you some of the ones, I hate name dropping, but I'm gonna drop a name. I worked with Laurence Olivier years ago at the National Theatre, and he was directing me in a play, and it was Three Sisters, and I was playing Three Sisters, Chekhov's Three Sisters, and I was playing Andre. And he seemed to like what I was doing, and he came to me just before we were breaking for lunch, and he paid me a big compliment, which was fantastic coming from him. And he said, you know, he said, what you have to learn now is to get the main body of the character. I said, how will I get that? And he said, take you about another 20 years to get there. He said, what you need is to relax, 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 relax. And Stanislavski talks about it in Building a Character. He talks about Othello, the moments when you're actually reaching great sort of climaxes of those moments in those great plays is physical relaxation. And it took me years to learn it. And so my method of working, and for my stage in my life now, career, whatever you want to call it, or position in this acting profession, which has been terrific. And if I can impart anything to you, is relaxation is the thing to aim for. And the only way I've reached this is to know what I'm doing, know what the text is, know the text inside out and backwards. Because the writer has put it down there for good, bad, or indifferent, whether it's Shakespeare or Chekhov or whoever, or Tennessee, whatever it is. Those are the thoughts that are down on the page. So I learn those things, and I take it that some magical process goes on inside. It's like preparing a recipe, and I let it cook inside me for a few weeks, and then when I'm ready to rehearse or start the play or whatever it is, whether it's a play or a movie, I'm ready because I know, I don't know consciously what's going on, but the thoughts that the author's put down, it seems very simple and straightforward. it's so simple in a way that people say, well, it can't be that simple, but I think it is that simple, and it is that complicated. It's like treating mean in that kind of simple, you know, that simple open-mindedness, because it's given me a good life, and I've met some fascinating people. I guess that's all I can say. Thank you very much.
Discipline to achieve anything worthwhile, sometimes the discipline, that's all you've got. It's easy not to have it. Most people don't expect it. They say, what the hell? But you know the difference, and you feel the difference, and it affects everything. You did the work, and now you've got to own it. It's yours. You have kind of a responsibility to that, whatever you do. If you want to do justice to the other talents that you're involved with, whether it's the author who may be dead, or the flesh and blood actor opposite you who wants the scene to work, or the costumer, or the lighting people who care so much that everything comes out right, you got to do your job. And of course, there's the audience. They come into the theater or turn on the set just to laugh, maybe just for diversion. Maybe, but you owe them the best of yourself. First of all, you owe them the belief that this thing that's been going on for so long, this art, has something to it. Also, you have a responsibility to that open heart that each of one of them brings to you. And this actually is what I tell commentators, as well as actors, is that no matter how predisposed someone's judgment, they can be gunning for you all they want with their judgment. The human heart is always open to be touched, and it can't help it. And an artist should have the grace to go out and meet such a thing prepared. And you all have invested the time and energy in that preparation. You are serious people, and we need all the serious people we can get. For all the money and fanfare and the big show business machine, like Mark was saying, it all comes down to that essential human being there. And that's where something can break through, and we can all be educated. It's drama, it's old, beautiful, this weird art. And you know how to do it because you took the time to learn. And I'm so proud of you guys. I just love the hell out of you. And I'll end now with a couple lines from a poem. We're all fellow travelers along life's weary way. If anyone can play the pipes, in God's name, let them play. You can play. Well done.
Basically, that whether it will increase in certainty or uncertainty.